Welcome to the Troy City Council special study meeting for December 15th, 2014. So we'll call that meeting to order. The roll call, Ms. Bittner.
Mayor Slater.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Campbell.
Here.
Councilmember Fleming.
Here.
Councilmember Henderson.
Here.
Councilmember Hoderick.
Here.
Councilmember Pennington.
Here.
Councilmember Teets.
Here.
All present. We have one discussion item this evening. C1 is an update from Media Genesis regarding Troy's brand. And I will turn the table over to City Manager Kishnick.
Thank you, Mayor, City Council members. This project of rebranding the City of Troy started about a year ago, and maybe a little longer than that, but approximately a year ago, and the hiring of a marketing coordinator, Andrew Obeluski, who works with Cindy Stewart in the Community Affairs Office, talking about how we should unify our message. And then a letter came from a local Troy business, Media Genesis, who you'll hear from tonight, giving a critique of the city's logo and some other things throughout the city. And so we said, let's go through a process to determine what the best use of resources would be in terms of rebranding. Logo is really what we're talking about tonight. And Andrew Obeluski is going to be our person to introduce Media Genesis, who will talk about the process today. Before Andrew gets up and talks, I just want to say what we're doing tonight is it's an update to the council, so you know where we are, and then get your feedback on what you're seeing and feeling, and so that we know going forward it's a total team effort. So, Andrew?
As Mr. Kishnick mentioned, this process started about a year ago, and it's a pretty involved process. We've gone out and we've done our homework. We've met with several community groups. We've met with the Chamber's business team. We've met with the Teen Advisory Board from the Troy Public Library. We've also sent out several different surveys through various social media sites to the residents of Troy and gotten good response from them on kind of a foundation for what we're trying to do with this rebranding. And anytime you do a rebranding, there's a lot of parts involved. And what we're going to be talking about tonight is just one of those parts, and that's a logo. So Brian did a great job introducing it. So I'll turn it over to Antoine from Media Genesis here and let him take you through what we've got.
Wonderful. Well, good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Feel free to interrupt me. I'm going to show you essentially an accelerated process of a few months of work in the context of this presentation. If there's something you have a question about, just let me know, jump in. Ask a question. And obviously part of this is to incite a discussion about what might be the right logo for the City of Troy. The process on our end started really with something we noticed. We've been longtime corporate residents of the city. We have a building right across from Montana, at the corner of Maple and Stevenson. We employ about 40 people there. We've been in business since 1996 and done a lot of work with all kinds of organizations, large and small. One of the things we noticed is when I drive into Troy, I always see that placard out there that's, got that little sign that says the City of Tomorrow today. And then I'm looking at the logo as it is, and this actually is just one iteration. There are many iterations floating about. And even if you walk through this building, you'll see various uses of the city seal and various typography treatment, things of that nature. And we're saying, gosh, this is kind of a little bit all over the place. And more importantly, when I think of it in the context of the statement, City More Today, and I look at the elements that are used, there's something that's not syncing, because we're making a statement about tomorrow, but we're using iconography, visual systems and fonts that are actually quite old. This font is a Bodoni, it's a font from the 1700s. It had a resurgence in the 60s, but it's definitely not communicating something that says new, fresh, up to date. So the statement that we make along with the logo doesn't really match. And same with this style of, it almost feels like, you're looking at a little bit of a stamp, but it's reminiscent of something you'd see 20 years ago or 30 years ago, perhaps. And I know there's been a refresh to this logo, but in short, it's time to really look at it more critically. So that's the activity we started with. So we had an August 6th, a kickoff meeting, and we had a number of the people that you actually have here in the room. And there was a lot of discussion about the objectives that a rebranding might have. And there was some discussion about the process we can utilize. The thing with the logo is you can just literally start sketching one out and jump straight to that. But the truth is the likelihood of that really achieving this objective is much lower if you don't first really spend some time looking at the climate of other cities that are nearby, what they've done to reinvent themselves and position themselves. If you don't listen to the constituents, both internal and external, and how they perceive the city and where the perceived needs, how this needs to be perceived, if those things are taken into consideration, the likelihood of something we just start sketching out of the blue to really hit the mark is low. So the thought process was really to start mapping it out, mapping a process to find it. And so these are the guiding principles and project goals. And we really started working through a set of steps, a brand assessment, where you are today in the context of the use of your brand, what we call an audience message action, which is who are the people we're trying to talk to, what are the messages we want to communicate, what are the actions we want them to take. And then creative ideation, and then two different rounds of revisions. And at this point, we're at this stage right here of the process, and then the next step is really to get to the final revisions. So the idea is that we want to make sure that we did our homework before coming here, but then we also had plenty of time and room to be able to then take into account the feedback you give us to finalize the logo. Okay, so that's the process side of the equation. So the first thing we looked at is, we looked a little bit of your demographic study. You know, there's a few things that characterize the city and make it different than others, right? We've got a higher educational attainment than many of the surrounding communities. We are not just safer than other communities, we are one of the safest communities in the state, if not the country. There is a tremendous amount of people here that are in the professional, scientific, or technical fields. We have a fairly diverse group of people. We have a median age of 41.8 years old. And again, I know this data may be dated. You know, there's a lot of, I think this is a few years ago that this information was gathered. And then the next piece is we wanted to see this in the context of other cities that are nearby. Now, we understand these cities may not have the same mix in terms of business, residential, and retail, for example, that Troy may have. But it's interesting to notice that some of those have gone through some very progressive rebranding efforts. Ferndale, Royal Oak, which granted have a different entertainment district than we do here. But you've got other places, Lathrop, Rochester Hills, that visibly show signs of a fresh and new identity that's been done in the last few years. And some of these things get pretty specific. For example, Ferndale will change the color here to distinguish different city departments. So there's different systems that have been used by different cities to not just communicate the city, but also a system that helps categorize various services that are offered within it. Okay, so from there, we wanted to, before we got started into a logo design, we want to know how that logo is going to be used. It's one thing to talk, say, about Ford and how it uses its logo, and we know what those uses are, right? Commercials, cars, badges on those things, and so on and so forth. We have to think in the context of a city, where is this logo going to be used? Because if we design something in abstraction that looks great on a piece of paper, but then looks bad in every communication that you send out, that's not going to help us. So we got to think about how it's going to be utilized. So to do that, we started asking the internal teams to start mapping out the most common uses of the logo. And we start identifying in a spreadsheet the most common uses that include things such as signage, Troy Today, and all kinds of other places where the logo might live. And we talked about how, is this a high distribution? Is this a high visibility, a low visibility? And what are the different uses? So we created all this, and part of the reason for it is we wanted to make sure that we didn't design this logo and all of a sudden people wondered, great, now what? And now we realize, wow, we got to redo the signage, we got to redo all kinds of things, and that becomes a big burden. And if we don't go into knowing that, then the chances again of this logo becoming adopted and used become really low. So we wanted to go in having all the pieces figured out. So the team internally here did a lot of homework of talking to each of the major groups within the city and mapping out their most common uses of the logo, and all these are available in a spreadsheet. Okay? So that's going to be helpful in the next stage of this process, because we can know exactly what we need to change and what's going to have the most visual impact for people. So let's talk a little bit about kind of the concept of regions and how logos start having a certain meaning. So one thing that we did in the presentation, we started talking about how certain cities and certain areas have become associated with a specific concept. This might not be exactly the concept you have in your mind, but I think most of us can agree that you talk about Paris, it's generally an idea about romance. When we talk about Milan, there's an idea about style. You talk about New York, you've got energy. You talk about Washington, you've got power. You talk about Michigan, we spent a lot of money as a state in the last few years making this PURE campaign, and it's gotten a lot of awards, it's gotten a lot of interest nationally, and so we've created this connection with PURE. So it begs the question, what's Troy? What are the identifying words that start becoming associated with the city? And that's where the challenge is, because I bet you that if we go around this table and we play this exercise internally with all of us, we start talking about what those words ought to be, it's unlikely that we're all going to have the same word in our mind. So it's not that simple. We're not going to go out there and say that it's that singular that we can peg ourselves with one of these singular words. We have more than that. We have different communities here that we service, and they have different values that they care about. And this is something you know all too well, being in the seats where you are, because you hear from citizens on a regular basis. And I'm sure you hear sometimes heated discourse about things that people disagree on, right? It'd be the same here on the branding discussion. So the next step was, okay, what are all those words? What's that environment in universe of those words? So we can start identifying the ones we want to project in a new brand. Okay, so that was the next part of the activity. And so what we did is we did what we call an AMA process. And the AMA process is really a discussion where we talk about all the stakeholders that come in contact with the city of Troy as a brand. And really what we wanted to do first was start with a totally open slate in this room. We had the screen rolled up, and we filled this board full of all the audiences and characteristics and things that were of interest to those audiences. And so these were all the people that were involved in this particular group. And we mapped all this out, and you can see some terrible handwriting, which is essentially these are all the audiences. And if you look at it, you've got about 20 to 30 audiences. So everything from schools, shoppers and diners, businesses, people that are really in the entertainment, that come here for entertainment, people who come here for you know the different schools such as Walsh, the development people, media, state and county representatives. You know, tons of people have contact with the city in one fashion or another. And then we identified certain things that we wanted to have resonate about, you know, these values they may have. And so the thought process with this, the reason why we do this is because we want to try to get to understand the users and how people on the receiving end of this message, this visual message, are going to interpret it and what matters to them. So there's a general marketing adage, which is we look at you versus them, them being the audiences we're catering to. And the closer we can get to them in understanding who they are and marketing to that target audience, the better. So an example I often use is in the automotive sector. It'd be really easy for automakers, and some of them do it, to speak in the context of all the physical characteristics of a vehicle. You know, it's 23 cubic feet of storage, it's got a 300 horsepower with 32 valve, blah, 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 blah. And you notice that a lot of the car marketing has gone from that sort of speak, which granted some enthusiasts really care about the Hemi and everything else, but for the most part now they're talking about how you're gonna use that, right? What does that really mean to you? So they start showing you how you use those features in the context of your day-to-day life, and instead of showing you a whole lot about the car, they place it in the context of your lifestyle. And they really sell to lifestyle, not to the vehicle. Have you noticed that? And that's a common trend here. We want to get to know all those values and interests of those users, because if we can then develop a brand that they relate to as an aggregate, the more likely it'll be adopted, the more likely it'll have the effect that we want to have upon them in terms of the perception of the city. So that's the kind of reasoning here, was to get out of our own structure, you know, the departments, the way that the city is, you know, organized and classified and everything else, the Dewey Decimal System of the city, so to speak, and move more towards the citizens, the residents, the people who come in for dining or shopping, and so on and so forth. Okay, so because of that, there's a few things that started coming out as key concepts. One of them was, there's this notion of anonymity, and anonymity meaning that you can live in the city and do your business, and this is not a place where there's a lot of drama, and that's good. You want a certain kind of stable, comfortable, healthy environment. There's a sense of beauty. You know, we have wide roads, we have larger lots, we have a lot of green spaces, there's a lot of good things going on. There's cleanliness. This is a place where you don't have to worry about your garbage being picked up. It's kind of like those magical elves that run around and make the city function the way it ought to function. That doesn't happen necessarily in every city out there, right? Not every city is as well run in that respect. There's a sense of concierge service. There's a sense of, the reason why Somerset's here is it's that sort of sense of, you know, there is a higher level of sophistication in terms of services and what you expect out of that. So that's a concierge level type of thing. Healthy was a big word that was also brought up, a sense of peace and calm. So in other words, these ideas that are, this is not what, for example, Royal Oak is trying to be, like, you know, which is, I think, is it Life Happening Now? Is it, which one is it? No.
Life Now Playing.
Life Now Playing, right? Life Now Playing, that's not really Troy, right? We're not trying to say, like, this is Rio de Janeiro and it's a party, right? That's not really the message. The message, this is a good place to have a family, it's a good place to have a business, it's stable, it's predictable, it's healthy, it's grounded, you know, those kinds of things. And then on the flip side, we have a bunch of different audiences, families, seniors, business owners, both prospective and existing, and then shoppers and diners. And this right here is a combination of different people that kind of reflect the faces of Troy. Is it exactly a match? Is it proportionally correct in terms of the age groups and the ethnicities? No. But it's meant to also remind us that we're looking at real people, you know, with real age groups, interests, ethnicities, religious beliefs, and everything else. And we want to make sure that we're encompassing all of those. And we want to make sure we're thinking about these as real individuals when we look at this particular branding. Okay. So the next piece, and this is a good example of, I think, how we use this, right? So the next piece is, what's the message we're going to put with this logo? Having a logo is one thing. How you use it is a whole different thing. So for example, LA here, you enter LA, you know, I mentioned to you the message about the city is more today and how that just didn't jive with the logo and the font. Well, I look at LA and I look at this, and first thing I think is, holy shit. He called 911, like, we're not welcome, you know? No. Watch out. You've entered chaos.
Beware.
Yeah, not good. Welcome to Miami Beach, good. I'm happy. This makes me feel good, right? Like, this looks like what I would expect, right? Neon, palm trees, good. You know, not so good. Right? So part of it is, what do we want to communicate and how do we use a logo? It's not just about having a logo, it's about placing it correctly, using it in the right context. There's something kind of unusual, by the way. Troy, where the city offices are located, happens to be in one of those visible spots in terms of, if you were an advertiser and if you were to look at the, you know, the traffic, you know, mm-hmm. advertisers look at the number of daily views on a billboard. This is pretty much a gold area, right? 75 Big Beaver, I mean, doesn't get much better than that, right? So that's something that you have as an interesting advantage, and I think there's an option down the road to really talk about how you can really make Troy become very visible for any person in traffic on those two high freeways. And that's something, if you'd have to pay for that advertising, would cost thousands and thousands of dollars a month. So food for thought as it applies to this. Okay, so we started with the first round, and the first round we did really in black and white, and we came up with a bunch of different ideas and logos. There were portal concepts. By portal, we mean that you saw through kind of a cutout, and you saw a logo through that. And you start seeing things that reflect nature, city, typography. And then we start using some other shapes, such as the team. And again, even highlighting the concept of these buildings within them. And this was kind of the first idea. And this started, and there's a whole bunch more that I'm not showing you today, that started a whole lot of conversations. And because of that, we said, okay, let's take all that feedback and organize it. So this was 9:25, so this goes back a little while. And we started saying, okay, let's start getting feedback in an organized fashion so we can really start defining what worked and what didn't work. So the process we used is we created a questionnaire. And this questionnaire started identifying, what of these shapes do you like? What should it reflect? Should it reflect residential? Should it reflect commercial retail? What should be visually associated with the brand? And then what color palettes work? What shapes are better? You know, what actual fonts are better? So we had not only logos to look at, but we also had a way to categorize them. Because the problem with a lot of logo stuff is people often will say, I like it or I don't like it, and I'll know when I see it, but I don't really have the vocabulary to tell you what I like or dislike about it. It's kind of the same thing with a lot of artwork. If you've not gone and done any kind of art history classes or whatever, you can't say, well, this Caravaggio style of painting with some lighting over here, is that's the part I don't like. You know, you say, I just don't know what I don't like about it, but I don't like it, you know, or I like it, but you can't necessarily express it. So part of it was to break it down. What are the shapes? What are the visual elements? What are the colors? And so on and so forth. This was actually really helpful, because what it showed us was that there was extreme polarization on a number of issues. In other words, the group that we convened believed in large part, almost uniformly, in certain things, and there were a couple of points where the group was split, and we had to make some decisions. So this is what happened here. So we had a few things that we discovered. One of them was the single identifier, the notion of the letter T being utilized, came out really strong in this particular questionnaire. It really popped to the top. The typeface that was most likely Century Gothic, and I'll show you some samples of that in a little bit. The color palette that people liked was more bright, more jewel colored, but there were some discussions later on we discovered that we also wanted to avoid things that were too bright, too flamboyant, too, you know, Pepsi Cola, and we'll talk about that in a second as well. So there was an executive decision also at that point to really start saying we had some decisions about where we include a lot of visual elements of residential, commercial, and all that. And part of it was the existing logos has a lot of those. And then the question is that limiting? Are we putting too much emphasis on, you know, business, commercial, retail, and all that stuff, and all that stuff, and became complicated. So the thought was to simplify it, just use the letter T as the identifier. So from there, we created a second study, and really what you're going to see is the output of that, and that's really the main purpose of this discussion. And that was actually about a month ago when we looked at that. And we started saying, let's put these logos in play. In other words, in the context of how they might be utilized, so that you can really see how a logo could live in some kind of an environment, whether it's signage, whether it's a mug, a t-shirt, a business card, that we can really relate to it the way you would see it. And we think that's really important, because looking at, again, logos and abstractions, it's very rare for you to see any logo just on its own. You're always going to see it with something, with a brochure, with a badge on a car, on some product. So we always want to make sure we provide some context for it, which is what we did here. We created context to show these logos. So we had a whole universe of really neat things to work from, right? These are not all, but a sampling of some of the logos that we created. Some of them we played around with just sketching things and things that look like shields. Some of them had kind of like FedEx, this hidden shape of a T, you know, hidden inside a different color box. Others were much more literal, like these. And some of these just didn't work quite as well. Like we started getting into things that got more Hellenic, you know, with horse and things like that. And that becomes a little bit of a liability, too close to the city seal and other issues with that. And then there were certain shapes that worked out and didn't. So this was kind of the whole study. And then we started reducing it. So now we're looking at the final list, essentially, within that grouping. And that's what you have in front of you on paper. So feel free to write notes on it as we discuss it. And then I'm going to walk through all of those. And then after that, turn it back, I think, over to you, Ryan, for discussion. Back to you. So here's the first one. What we're looking at here is a very simple shape of a T. What's nice about it is that the T becomes part of the whole canvas. In other words, when you see it on white, the T is actually literally continues right into the white of the page. Mm-hmm. So that gives you a really nice feel of being comprehensive. It has these two colors that can offset each other, meaning that there's a nice balance. It looks good in black and white, but it also can really have some nice effects depending on two colors we juxtapose with one another. In theory, if we wanted to, we could even create specialization to demonstrate certain departments by color. One of the things we've noticed is that as you walk around again, there's a lot of different uses of logos. If you go and look at signage on city buildings, you'll notice all kinds of different visual elements. You'll notice in different materials that are published by the city. So leaving some room for that customization might allow for people to play inside of the logo environment without having to recreate something totally new and potentially dilute the brand. So this is an example of where changing this palette here could affect that. Okay, so that's the first one. We call this one two-tone. Here's an example of a use. So again, we just plopped it here. I'm not necessarily suggesting this is what you need, a signage or where you should locate it or any of the variances required to make that happen, although I'm sure you could figure that out. But here's an example of what that would look like in a real context. So here's the logo, welcome to the city of Troy. Here's an example of an actual card. And you can see the use, we're reiterating the use of the curve. We'll be using, again, the white text on the dark color background as it is here. So it's reinforcing that visual message. Again, I think it's striking, highly recognizable. And I think people would quickly start associating this shape, if it's done properly and properly, you know, reinforced throughout, with the city. In other words, I think you could show this and people would recognize it. And Royal Oak does that a lot already. I don't know if you've noticed just the ROs, you'll see that. And they've reduced it to remove all other elements. That's a common trick. Nike does that too. You know, they've reduced it to a single shape and they've made it so recognizable that we just need to see the shape to see it. So that's a good trait to have, something that you can stamp up, and it's a very simple, highly visually recognizable shape that you don't have to put a lot of text around it to explain what it is. So that's the first example. Just to show you another example, it could be very different. So you could, you know, have a totally different style of that logo. It could be very fresh in that respect. So you could literally customize it depending, and I'm not necessarily suggesting that you have all these variants, but you could have a palette to be used for different purposes. So second idea, this one we call this one intersection. You're going to start seeing a theme that starts coming out of this T. T is not just Troy for the letter T. It's also something that's a very visual recognition of the shape of that we have of 75 in this Big Beaver corridor. And this notion of an intersection, two roads that connect with one another in the form of a T, exists here. So here we really have three different elements, and they can also be dialed with color combinations. Again, now we've reintroduced a circular element, but it's now contained kind of what we saw like in the portals, and then the typography is outside of that particular statement. What's nice for this logo is it wouldn't be very difficult to also put it over here. So in other words, you could put the type over here. So you could potentially use it both vertically and horizontally, very easily. And same thing, a shape that becomes very recognizable. So here's another example of how this could be used, you know, in different purposes. So a coffee mug, and again, this could be based on the, you know, some of the larger corridors and lights, or engraved on a briefcase. So you know, lots of different potential uses here. The next one, we call this one Avenue. Again, you'll see the same kind of recurring theme of this notion of intersecting roads. And one of the things I think is kind of nice about this, again, if you think of your 75 corridor and Big Beaver, two different kinds of roads, freeway and a highway, and in this case, they're connected together And there's a space that kind of also indicates what you might conceptualize as a kind of an entrance ramp of some kind. And there's something kind of very aesthetic about the simplicity of this design. It is not a single predictable shape of a T. It really is a created shape. And again, the color can really add some element of customization to that. And we're showing you lots of different color examples. Obviously, we can pick any single one, or there could be more than one accepted as a proper logo palette that we can use. So here's an application of that. Again, letterhead, shirt, and you know, an actual jersey. Mission style is the fourth. We call this more mission style because it has those craftsman kind of style elements of lots of different kind of ridges like this. And again, this could be played with, but the idea is that you've got intersecting blocks that compose the shape of a T. There's some more architectural elements to that. You know, one of the things we do have here is we do have you know, multiple business sectors that have these higher rises. So this kind of also brings that to light. It is something that has a lot more structure and an order and a lot more visual information. While the other ones were very simple shapes, this now has a lot of shapes to contain it. And it's also quite obviously vertical. This would not be something we could use both in vertical and horizontal. It would very much be a vertical logo. So here's an example of how that may be used. So this could be a large monument. And it could be used on a print piece in this fashion. And again, it's got a very classic element. Anytime you've got these more hard edges, it's got a certain kind of stability and more classic element versus something more dynamic, such as the more fluid shapes you saw earlier. Okay. That's it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. Any questions from council for Councilman Teese?
So are we proposing a change in the tagline as well?
I think the tagline should definitely be looked at. We haven't dug into that piece of it, as you noticed, but I think that's something that should definitely be looked at afterwards, yeah. And those things can play with one another, for sure.
I guess, like you said, like I understand a logo and tagline go hand in hand. It seems like cards before the horse. Or maybe I misunderstand or don't understand. I mean, I'm looking at a logo, but I don't know the tagline. So
I think we're in study session and we're just kind of getting different portions of it, not all together, but not to make any one decision tonight. There will be other study sessions. My understanding is to talk about that and how they blend and things of that nature. But am I kind of understanding tonight that the committee and the recommendations have come sort of whittled down to this area?
Yeah. You want to answer that?
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much the process. I mean, the process now is we've gone through two large sets of logos that have now been reduced the first time through a questionnaire to identify kind of what was important. And again, all these were rooted in discussions and intake that were done with a lot of people. The second one now has really become narrowed in enough that we're able to put it in the context of how it can be used. There's no doubt that there's all kinds of, you know, the tagline thing is a very valid point. At least this, any one of these logos would work with the current tagline. In other words, you wouldn't have something that's that divergent. I'm not suggesting you necessarily keep the current tagline. I think that needs to be looked at as well. But I think there's a lot of other things to consider, such as how does this get rolled out? In what fashion is it actually shown to the public? How do we make sure it gets adopted? These kinds of activities are things that are really important. You don't want to go out there and go, gosh, you know, we didn't put the right energy behind it, and therefore it's not getting really adopted by the public, you know. So there's no doubt that there's some other elements like that need to be figured out. But first, we have to figure out the direction the logo is headed in so we can make sure we marry the two together. So, for example, tagline and then rollout use.
So tonight, you're kind of trying to get consensus from council to go in this direction as opposed to the gazebo look or the scenery look or the
can't do it without tagline. What's that?
I'm just a touch befuddled because the logo that we currently have doesn't match the tagline that we currently have. Right. Now we're going to have a different logo, and we're going to make the tagline match a different logo.
What I heard, what I heard Antoine say was, maybe you need to say it a little louder.
Well, we have to start somewhere, right? So I mean,
okay.
So this is the first step. We know exactly. We know right now,
gotcha.
In a very simple way, we know that when you look at the logo and the tagline, they don't work together. And it's not that the tagline is bad, I think. The tagline, I don't have necessarily a problem with the tagline, personally. What I can tell you is when I look at the tagline with the logo together, they make a statement that doesn't connect, because we're making a statement about the city of tomorrow by using iconography and typography of 1600s, 1700s. It doesn't match. So we have to start somewhere. The first part that's going to be the most recognizable is probably the logo. For example, if I were to ask, it's even why I had to recall the Royal Oak tagline. Taglines may change. Logos have a much longer lifespan. You know, Ford may change its tagline on a regular basis. Its tagline may even be different in different markets. But the logo itself is not going to change that often. They've had
McDonald's, a lot changed their tagline on it.
But the logo is really fundamental. And I think it's visually, first of all, it has a lot of impact because it's going to be in a lot of different ways, signage and everything else. Whereas the tagline may not exist in all those uses of signage. You might not have your tagline on a building signage, for example. And you may not even have it on a print piece that's being sent out for some notice that the city offers. So there's no doubt that those things are important because, you know, they do play with one another, but I would say the logo is definitely the more dominant and important piece to get right. The tagline then it should be aligned with the same things that we discovered in the process. So the values that we identified, you know, those values I started listing out, the tagline needs to connect with that, because aspirationally, the tagline should connect with the target audiences and communicate those values we described. So that's one thing. And there's been some different elements there, and it's not as easy to find a tagline. But once we have a logo, it'll become easier.
I think the history of Troy, anyways, I've been around for 40-some years, but I didn't deal with when we changed the logo the last time, but it's always kind of the history here is to keep the tagline and change the logo. Helen of Troy, I believe, was the first logo that we had. Then we went to the current one. So our tagline has always been the same. In fact, I think there's been some pushback. Every time we changed the logo, there was pushback to not change the tagline.
People are going to ask me after this meeting, right. Is the tagline going to be changed?
Yeah.
I was just wondering.
Right. I think that's what we need to talk about here, because there is, after this, we're going to get some emails. Councilman Pennington.
Can we go back to the these four here? The different ones. Just out of curiosity, that one. That one right there. Upon looking at the different four different choices, that circle, the T there, I'm just curious why it doesn't have a finishing circle around it, because the other ones all have a bold, it seemed like they finish off, and that one just kind of, you know, it just seems like it hangs out. I'm just curious what it was.
Yeah, so I mean, part of the idea here was to really get enough diversity but using the same set of rules. We knew that the T was a fundamental identifier that everybody seemed to view as important. We knew that it didn't need to be necessarily burdened with a lot of other visual elements, but the notion of adding a circle around it wasn't necessarily something that was universal, that everybody said that that was what they liked. So we wanted to give some options. So the same way that we see the last one being very vertically horizontal, vertical in terms of its approach,
yeah.
And also very much, it's a lot more visual elements. There's a lot more lines if you look at it that way.
Right.
Whereas this one is the opposite of that. It's very simple. You could almost brush stroke it with two brush strokes and call it there, you know?
Yeah.
So that's the idea, to show some differences inside of the parameters that we've discovered are good parameters for this brand.
And I like the idea of the I-75 and the Big Beaver. I thought that is great, but it just didn't seem like it just doesn't finish off.
Yeah. And we wanted to make sure that this was abstract enough that people may not necessarily think of that connection with the Big Beaver and I-75, but it is a very recognizable feature. And if you do know it and you see it, you'll never forget that's what it is.
Right.
You know? Yeah. So that's an advantage that becomes memorable.
Especially once it's explained. I mean, that's
right.
It's great.
And it becomes very good. And especially because, you know, again, we have such an unusual curvature of 75, right? I mean, and the fact that we match up with another big, you know, Big Beaver is very, it's a very wide road at that point, you know, compared to, say, other spots, you know, when you go 60 miles, for example, toward the Bloomfield area, you know, it really is a major thoroughfare. And
right.
It is where we have summer sets, so it's very recognizable for people. So I think this puts proper emphasis on both. The reason why we have it like this is to really separate the two as if they're different road systems. So we want to provide a little bit of a distinction between them.
And then can you go back a couple more slides?
Sorry.
Keep going. That one right there, Can you go back to where you started? See, the A, when I first saw A, when I was looking at this last night, I just thought of Pepsi. I thought of Pepsi right away.
And that's the colors. I think the colors, and that's a good example of how brands become highly memorable.
I don't drink Pepsi, but isn't Pepsi just like that?
Similar. I mean, you know, but I mean, you wouldn't think of it if you saw it like this, you know?
Right, different colors.
So again, it shows you that, you know, our brains become, I mean, there's all kinds of studies that show you that they change the fonts in commonly known logos. And you just glance right through it, you don't even notice that it's saying something totally different. Because we get, what happens is the typography becomes so ingrained in us through millions of dollars of marketing that we start forgetting, and we don't read it, we just treat it as a shape. So I think the goal with all those logos is to have something so memorable that it has that kind of instant recollection. The moment you see it, you know what you're looking at. And that's something that I think is an advantage of all these logos. All these logos have highly recognizable, simple shapes. You know, one of the things that I've got to commend the team on is that we didn't end up stuck in adding up. Sometimes when you have a lot of consensus, you end up adding more and more and more and more. And then the logo ends up being the kitchen, you know, everything in the kitchen sink. And that becomes not at all recognizable.
Right. Well, if the font's from the 1700s, we probably should look at it, you know, eventually change it. you want to do it one time, you want to do it right.
Well, you know, it's all the font uses here. So in the concept of fonts, we talk about serifed and sans-serif fonts. So serifed are the ones that have little wigglies that make you think of Gutenberg in the press. All these are fonts that don't have those little things ending at the end of the letters. And generally speaking, people see those as more approachable, more modern. Again, you know, you think of these highly ornate fonts, and you think of those as serif fonts as more classic. And I think a lot of this treatment really doesn't hone in on the classic as much as it does more modern. Mm-hmm.
Mayor Pro Tem Campbell.
Some curiosity, have you put a timeline together? Is this going to be coincided with something that's coming up in the future? Is this going to be like on Tuesday where I'm just going to do it? Or what's the overall plan to do this?
I'm sorry. Oh, you're right. No problem.
Yeah, no, probably, and not by year end. We really, this is just where we are in the process. We don't have a timeline.
I mean, is this something we're looking at completing before the birthday?
During the birthday, for
during
sure.
The birthday?
Mm-hmm. That's a good target.
So there is kind of a target.
I mean, we're continuing to move on. That's why we're here. We've whittled it down to these areas. Now the question is there anything you absolutely can't live with, or is there something that sticks out and seems to be appropriate and catches your eye?
Councilman Henderson.
Can you, I think it's two down. Oh, no, maybe the other way. Sorry about that. It's that one. Yeah, that to me, that almost looks like a church sign to me. You want to do a church parking lot?
It's a pastoral setting.
Yeah. It's definitely a more classic element. Part of it might be the way that it's set, the context it's set in. So do you feel that way about this? In both the card or just mostly the signage?
Mostly the signage, I think, but yeah, I like the one that Councilman Pennington was talking about as well. Better than that, but that one just, to me, just strikes me as a little.
And sometimes, you know, the context will affect that. In other words, by putting it in this thing that looks more, you know, classical, like, you know, the wooden stakes, it might infer more of that, you know, that could be changed.
I think on the baseball cap, it doesn't give the same impression to me did on the sign.
You're right.
Councilman Fleming?
Yeah, I'm surprised you said church, Dave, because when I looked at that, it looks like the real estate pole.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right.
You know, the little bits, you got the little pole there.
Oh.
And it's kind of cool.
With the what?
You know, you got a real estate sign, the pole, your standard sign that you hang out for real estate, like you're open for business.
Right.
You've got the little pole there, the little thing. A mailbox or real estate pole thing.
Troy, we're open for business.
We're open for business, man.
For sale.
For a price.
It's just a couple questions. I noticed you kind of stay away from the word Michigan.
Mm-hmm.
Is that on purpose?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I do think that the simplicity, the benefit that Troy has, Troy's a very short word.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And the more we add to it, the more we're going to make it more complex. And I think Troy is significant enough on its own, you know, both in terms of its, you know, when you look at the, you know, again, safest city in the state,
you look at the number of Fortune 500 headquarters and all the other things, I think there's plenty of brand equity that can be garnered without having to necessarily mention where it is. I mean, I think it's got enough strength to be able to command that without specifying.
I think that's true from Michigan, but there are two pretty significant Troys, one in Ohio and one in New York, that when you Google Troy, I was just curious, did you look at their logos?
No, I don't know if we have. I know there's even more other Troys in the state. There's a couple of Troy, I think, cities.
Troy Township.
Intersection. The street signs.
Oh, this one?
Yep. See, we can.
Yeah, I understand. I saw that there was Michigan. I just. I would be curious to know what the logo is for Troy, New York, and Troy, Ohio. Just out of curiosity. Councilwoman Hoerig.
I like the idea of the I-75 and Big Beaver when I'm wearing my commercial property filling. It works. But we're so much more. We are schools, we are so residential, we are parks, we're children, we're churches. And so for me, this logo here speaks to that more cleanly, and it allows for we're multiple intersections in Troy. It's what makes Troy, Troy. And it also speaks stability to me. It's just solid. So if we had like a golden quarter logo we were trying to finesse or something, that would work for me. But this comprehends the entire city for me. And it's still simple, but it's captured in that circle. If you never had the rest of the words, it works. With the words, it works. I like that you could do vertical or horizontal. I like that you could play with multiple colors and shading. It gives a lot of options, but it's so straightforward and simple. And there's no interpreting. There's no having to explain, you know what, that's looped there because there's a ramp and there's I-75 and there's, you know. I don't know, I just, maybe there's a, when you go back and you're doing this, and I think, you know, Councilman Campbell's talking about timelines. I think we're just bubbling up ideas here amongst ourselves. This is a really early design phase as far as I can tell. You know, maybe there's room to play with that, and especially comparing to the other Troys, but I like this one.
Just to be clear, from a project standpoint, it's not really early on. We're a little further down, just from the research, but you bring up a lot of great points about that, because the other one we thought about with this one is kind of the three components of like the live, work, play.
Yeah.
And just it really could work in a lot of different ways.
I think I'm talking about the process of our city branding. This is such a first piece, and I want to say out loud, I'm not interested in having a dialogue about changing our city of tomorrow today. We will have, people are so, have strong opinions about that one way or the other. If we could just update our look, if we accomplish that, that'd be a great branding step that then we can protect.
I think I agree with you. I don't think the tagline per se is problematic. I mean, I don't think that's an issue. I think the visual logo is very dated. You know? So, you know, and again, I think we can validate that. To your point, you know, I think you can find meaning. All these have abstraction in them, and you can find an associated meaning with each piece. For example, like the way Brad was explaining, live, work, play could be a factor of these three different highlighted areas. But again, you won't know that unless somebody tells you that. And even the shape of the T, I bet you many people won't consciously realize that unless, again, it's explained. So some of these things can be left somewhat mysterious, you know. And there's no doubt that there's been a lot of discussion about polarizing the city down to this intersection. I mean, we even looked at the shape of Troy to see if there were things that were highly visual in that respect. It's such a big area, you know, and it's not a nice, you know, triangle, circle, you know, it's not like we're dealing with a shape that we could necessarily use. It's large, you know, it's a large area, and it's not necessarily a simple, recognizable area. Mm-hmm. What is recognizable, though, is a shape, is that intersection. People do recognize it. Mm-hmm.
I think just from my perspective, it's tough for me to move from a picture to a logo, you know. because I come from maybe that era or something, and I understand that logo is, you know, like Nike and McDonald's and all that. That's probably what it is there for, to be recognizable. So I understand that concept. So I think at least tonight, I think what we're, is this a direction that we want to move away from, you know, pictures and trees and gazebos and buildings to a logo? And it looks like that's what you're recommending. That's the younger generation looks to that branding. So that's, I think, what we're here tonight to see. Are we going to move away from that and move towards more of a logo like this? I see Councilman Teets. Just thinking.
I guess I have questions along those same lines. I mean, you look at Rochester Hills, they just went through rebranding. There has a distinctive Rochester Hills look to it. And I think, I realize that Royal Oak and some other places have this type of, but frankly, we're not Royal Oak, and pleased with who we are. And so I have some questions that way. This is all beautiful, and I think these would all work, but I just, I'd like to see a larger sample of some of these other places, what they're doing in some of our competing cities. I mean, Novi, Livonia, Canton, you know, Plymouth, Northville, places that we compete with day in, day out for business. And, you know, I know we compare to Pleasant Ridge, to a couple other places, in fact, there are communities in Cone County as well, and Manchester. But I think, you know, let's compare apples to apples. I mean, businesses don't say Pleasant Ridge or Troy, and I think proximity-wise, but they're similar, but not in style, type of people we're trying to attract, so forth and so on. So those are my, that's all my feedback in one shot.
And, you know, I don't want to get too complicated here, you know, because I think the gazebo in the buildings is dated, and I think we do need a change. I think after hearing this tonight, I've probably moved away from a picture myself, because I do like that concept where you look at something and you know that's Troy, whatever it is. I think when people look at our gazebo and our buildings, they don't know that that's Troy, unless you put the word Troy right next to it. You know? And I think if you took Rochester Hills picture and didn't put the city of Rochester Hills there, you wouldn't know that that's Rochester Hills. And I think that's where you're coming from.
I mean, you know, there's definitely definite advantages and pros and cons to things like more visual. And, you know, the trick is, you know, with branding, simplification and repetition are going to be fundamental exercises, because that's how people are going to internalize it. So obviously you want to make sure if you do that, that you start carrying the right message. So okay, that's one of the key questions. Are these essentially still communicating the right message? To the point, I think not only is there a lot of visual information with the current Troy logo, I bet you if you did a visual test, just by heading at a certain distance, and you try to recognize what the elements are, very difficult to do.
Oh, yeah.
So those are little tests that you can use with the brand, and that really starts driving home the point about simplification. If you think about the brands that are most recognizable, and there's a big difference between the city and Nike and McDonald's and all that, but there's also something we've learned about the things that make the brands so popular. And if you think about the brands that are most popular, think about what they are, you'll notice inevitably they are simple, 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 simple shapes. Apple, simple shape. IBM, simple shape. G, simple shape. GM, simple shape. McDonald's, simple shape. Things that become stamped, you know, quite literally in your head. So I'm not suggesting that you have to go down that route. What I'm saying is that gives you a huge advantage in terms of recognition and recognizing.
Councilman Pennington, and then Councilman Fleming.
I like the idea of going with a logo that it looks, like you said, it's so much more up to date. But aren't most logos a single color? Now, if we went with one of these, would wouldn't you advise going with a single color? You wouldn't change, be changing, like...
There would probably be three core uses. There'd be a color use, black and white use, and a reverse use. So reverse use would be when you see it on a, you know, on a dark colored background. And then there could be some people don't have a color use. They may have just a two-color logo, you know, background and foreground. But you can definitely have multiple colors like these. What we do try to do with logos is keep everything what we call vector. So what that means is that we don't have gradient colors that change, and we don't have a whole lot of little pieces within it, so that when you scale it, you can make it as big as you want, and it's not going to lose any of its proportions. Again, you don't have to do that. Some logos, and I'll show you some examples of logos that don't do that. There's one that we looked at earlier. So for example, some of this stuff might be a lot harder. You see how this is more like an image. When you try to scale that, sooner or later, you're going to start, it's going to start breaking into all these little pixels.
Right.
This, you can scale that as big as you want, and the proportions of those ratios will always stay true.
Right.
And it's also visually easier. This is also a scalable logo. So we try to avoid things that have a lot of fine detail, because that's when you start getting a lot of that breakage. Again, these are, they're not best practices that make it easier for lots of uses.
Mm-hmm. And I don't know why so many sitters go with green, but you know, if we had our choice, you know, we were talking about things we don't like. I mean, if we're going to throw out some things, you know, I would not want to, you know, go with green. I mean, you know, I don't know what the rest of the group is thinking, but I wouldn't want to stay with the horse. You know, I'm glad we went away from that horse theme, and then I wouldn't want to go with the green. So, I mean, that would be the, if we're talking about things we want to get rid of.
That's because you support Michigan, not Michigan State. You know, so.
Well, look at why I'm green.
Everything
cool. Oh, Dane.
Excellent points made tonight. I mean, a lot of work's been put into this. I tend to agree that we need to go with a letter, not with signs and so forth, because that gets dated too. But I think the letter, but the mayor made a very valid point too. We need to look at all the other Troys in the country, really, but big, larger geographical area, because don't kid ourselves, we're not competing with just the local cities here. We're competing globally. And so we want our logo to be distinguishable. When somebody calls up Troy, you know, that's all they got, Troy, or Troy, Michigan, that it is distinguishable from not even close to what anybody else is doing. I like the intersection concept. I like the stuff that's scalable, that's easy to embroider, to logo, do whatever, to make things out of. This simple T here is that way. It's easy, it's scalable. Your what you call intersection style.
Yep.
It could be the avenue style, either way. I'm not hung up on either one. But you definitely want something that's very versatile, that can be used and scalable. And I think going with the letter T, whatever you choose, is, you know, style you choose is fine. And colors, just stay away from the Pepsi color. You need to go with other colors. But the key is looking to see what other communities with the name Troy, what they have. We don't want to copycat.
If I did, anybody. If I could just, I was shown a couple of examples, and I thought it was true, I just didn't want to say it, but Troy, New York emphasizes New York, that they're from New York. Ohio does emphasize that they're, or Troy, Ohio does emphasize they're from Ohio. And I, you know, I just think that Troy, Michigan probably needs, people
stand out.
Need to stand out.
Sure.
Because there are other Troys in other states, you know.
Looks like Cedar.
Ohio.
That looks like Cedar Point.
Right?
Yeah.
Probably Ohio.
Oof.
Nobody goes there.
And
you drove through
and
there.
And where it says city of, you can take that off and just have Troy, Michigan.
Wow. It's busy.
So two totally different looks. I mean,
yeah.
One will be right, it's like an amusement park or like a pop.
Yeah.
You feel like you're at a concession stand getting ice cream.
I didn't see any similarity to a letter whatsoever, so I think that's good.
Yeah.
But I do think, you know, we are from Michigan. But
Michigan.
Councilman Henderson,
yeah,
we need to wrap this up in about two more minutes.
The D, you know, welcome to the D is kind of a big thing, and the new D logo, I think it's in the casino in Detroit, is kind of cool, and I think people can really latch onto that. And I'm struggling to try to find another T town in this area. Taylor, Traverse City, and then
that's TC.
So I mean, in this general area, we got the only T.
We have the best T.
We have the best T for sure.
Towers. I think I've heard a consensus that if you want to wrap up, Brian.
We're gonna compare, we're gonna put together, compile a lot more logos of other communities. We'll put the Troy logo together, not to mention in Southeast Michigan, and maybe even go to some T communities and put those out there as well.
Keep calm and vote Troy. Yeah, I like that.
Tailor made for you is kind of cool, though.
Sorry, Brian. So that's what we'll do. And we, I think there's consensus to move to a, away from a picture to a logo.
Sounds good.
That's what I have.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
We will allow for public comment. Is there anyone, and I don't see anyone else that wishes to speak. So we will be adjourned.
And a timeline.